Every ceiling I've shown you since the beginning of these lectures has always been a blue sky with stars with a few figures against the background. That's the only thing people thought you could do in a ceiling, because narrative vision on a ceiling would just be confusing. Paintings are meant to be seen as windows into a parallel world. So you can make things on a ceiling which are single figures floating against a blank backdrop, but the minute you try to create a scene that takes place in the natural world, you're geared to look horizontally in the natural world, not vertically. So when Michelangelo proposed stories in Genesis, Julius II has to have rolled his eyes and said, "You got to be kidding me." But that's not what ultimately, that's Julius II was persuaded by Michelangelo, who then produced the Sistine Chapel, which is going to be the work of what is obviously a sculptor. In this very first picture, this very first scene of the Sistine Chapel, you can see exactly what he's thinking. The reason why Michelangelo could do what other people could not is because Michelangelo had been training himself for the past 15 years as a sculptor. Sculptors do not think like painters. Painters have a space, they fill up the space, and so painters are supposed to be very busy. A sculptor takes a piece of stone, and with a hammer and chisel, he takes away, and he leaves a single dynamic form that can tell the whole story. The Sistine Chapel is a series of single sculptural forms that propel your attention across the down the lunette. And so we start with the separation of light and dark. It is color-wise white, gray, and pink. It has no particularly clever color combinations, but what it does have is an image of God drawn from the most famous ancient sculpture of its age, the Laocoon. That dynamic twist of Laocoon, who is dying. This is the image of the Trojan priest being killed by two serpents. He is dying. This is his last breath. Shows up again as God bringing existence into existence. You want something to understand Michelangelo. This is a man who looks at a pagan image of death, and he turns it into a Christian image of the beginning of all life. He then moves on to the creation of the sun, moon, and vegetable life. God comes flying in here. He comes flying out there. He leaves the moon, gray circle, the sun, yellow circle, and the vegetable life, two ferns and a dandelion. This is not a painting about stuff. It is a painting about God who is moving through space, energetically creating. Now, I know in your case, I am going to point out that it is a little odd to see God from the second angle. And I can tell you that even as we speak, about 70% of English-speaking tourists in the Vatican museums right now are explaining that the reason why we see God from the back is that God is mooning the Pope because he is mad because he has this job. And Michelangelo is passive-aggressive, apparently, like everyone else in the 21st century. That would be stupid if you're planning on never getting another job. And it also denies it is Michelangelo is working for a bunch of theologians who are going to get what he's talking about. As I remember, the only thing anybody was ever allowed to see of God was that Moses, who had that conversation, let me see your glory. And the compromise they worked out was that the only thing Moses would be allowed to see of God was his back parts. This happens to be placed right above the scene where Moses is asking to see God on Mount Sinai, so it's a little bit more obvious than it seems. But this is really, it's like a soft spot to enter into the next level of this painting, where you realize that whole chapel, none of it would happen if we were still stuck in that Old Testament, if we were still stuck in that pre-redemption era, because all we ever saw was what God lived in his wake. All we ever saw was God's back. But what we anticipate in the Sistine Chapel is seeing God face to face. We have the separation of earth and sky, beautifully described by a priest friend of mine as a liturgical pause. Everything stops for a moment before you get to the creation of man. And in the creation of man, there is so much going on that I'm going to limit myself to two points. One is an Adam who looks so spectacularly lazy, he looks like he's trying to hit the snooze button on the alarm clock. But at the same time, with the potential energy in the bent knee and the bent shoulder, which gives you the idea of something that has yet to be completed in this creation. This passiveness of Adam, this activeness, this purposefulness of God as he reaches towards Adam, you can feel that energy of God about to be transmitted. He leaves us at the edge of our seat waiting for that explosive moment to happen. On this side, you already see the next part of the story. Here is Eve looking at Adam. There's a very important thread of the Immaculate Conception in here. Eve looks at Adam, and here's that Christ child already. So he knows about the fall of man. His hand curls around Eve, splays on the shoulder of himself. In one scene, with the most incredible economy of figures, Michelangelo has just given you God creating man, all the while planning on erupting into human history to save him as Jesus Christ. It's an incredible synthesis of everything into a few short figures. This is just to show you where that baby comes from. That's how we know to look in terms of that. That baby is very similar to the one in the creation of man. And again, the creation of woman, dead center of the ceiling. I've already been heard to say this last night, but it might be that the reason why this is the dead center is that Adam was only practiced and then he finally gets it right. Or it could be because the chapel is dedicated to the Virgin Mary, so the front and center scene is to Mary. And the temptation and fall of man, which sums up basically everything I want to point out about Michelangelo. You have no fruit, flowers, no anything in Eden. Eden is the same on the inside and the outside. What changes? Adam and Eve in either one. Inside, it's not so much that they were in a great place landscape-wise. They were in a great place with God, and they were beautiful. We go back to our theme of beautiful. Grace in Italian means beautiful. You see them buoyant. You see them beautifully luminous. They move like ballet dancers. They fit together. We were talking about theology of the body, and the Father Granados had a really good observation. I can't see you. Where are there? You are. The beautiful. They fit together with a kind of this kind of perfect, very alignment. He's a little bit more aggressive. She's a little bit more yielding. But their fit is perfect. There's no shame. There's no discomfort. They're meant to be together. The fall of man sees their bodies change. That beautiful posture drops over. The light drains from her body. So their bodies. She is in his shadow. She's cowed underneath him. And the fact is, you can feel gravity working on them, because Michelangelo's only point about the fall of man, it's not that we were on this terrific beach and got stuck off in some frozen tundra. It's because our body became a burden with the fall of man. And he literally shows you, as only a sculptor can, he shows you this body which is a burden to bring with you. The next scenes will be the stories of man. You'll see the sacrifice of Noah, the flood, which has a very entertaining ark that looks like it can't float. It actually looks more like a church. I tend to think it's a 16th century way of saying now a word from our sponsor. And then we end up with the last scene of the Sistine Chapel ceiling. Has it ever occurred to you how incredibly weird it is that the Sistine Chapel opens with God creating light and ends up with some guy blind drunk in a barn? I mean, last I checked, that's the story of a downward spiral. The fact is that it's a very, very odd type of image. And the more striking thing about the image of Noah is when you compare it to the image of Adam. Three scenes earlier, there's all that potential that God is going to release in that beautiful image of Adam. And three scenes later, Noah's already dissipated. It's already lost. And at that moment of darkness, it's the darkest scene on the ceiling. Empirically, when you look at the cleaning, it's the darkest scene on the ceiling. And you're thinking, well, that was one failed experiment. And then Michelangelo brings you in to these new series of figures which are formed by the Sibyls and the prophets. And these men and women, they are gradually bringing you from Zechariah, who's over the entrance and exit door. Here's the drunkenness of Noah. You have to get back to the altar. You're being guided back to the altar by these men and women. So the Sibyls are for the pagan world. Remember yesterday, Santa Maria Maggiore? The pagans and the Gentiles and the Jews. You have, here's a Sibyl for the pagan world. You have Isaiah for the Jewish world. You have another Sibyl, men and women side by side. This is an extraordinary image for women, but that's a whole other lecture. You have the Daniel. As you're getting closer to the altar, they get larger and brighter, and we close with the most spectacular figure of all. From this Delphic Sibyl who turns your eye inwards, her colors are more saturated, to the monumental Sibyl who is closing the book in her flame-colored robe. And she brings you to, whoopsie-daisy, she brings you to the figure that Michelangelo waited 3.5 years to paint. This is the last thing he painted in the Sistine Chapel. He painted it on a piece of plaster that tilted towards you. and the figure looks like it tilts backward. There were four people, five people in the world who could do that kind of foreshortening. He is the only figure of the Sistine Chapel ceiling who is not placed in his niche. He's off balance, like the Jesus of the Pietà. He looks like he's going to fall off the ceiling, and where will he land? The altar is right below. And you already know what that means. It goes all the way back to the earliest Christian art, art that Michelangelo knew full well, the Jonah, who has always been the symbol of the death and resurrection of Christ. The Sistine Chapel is an itinerary. It takes you from the first day of the world, where God flips on the light and starts creating. It takes you to the culmination of his creation, which is man. You have man's fall, man's disgrace, the slow crawl back to God, the glory of God and the redemption, and it closes with the image of the Last Judgment. Now, I have one more thing I would just like to play for you. I think I'm going to play this for you at the end here. Where are you? I think I'll see if this works. It actually has music, but I like to sum it up in Michelangelo's own words. Michelangelo, this is a poem written by Michelangelo when he was working on the Last Judgment, and I'm going to sort of leave you with these thoughts and really what makes, and this, particularly in these two lectures, but everything I've been trying to tell you since we started here. I find Michelangelo is actually our greatest mouthpiece. My talk yesterday was about how Michelangelo gets distorted and pulled in every possible direction except for one where he can be a powerful mouthpiece for what Christians believe, and since he works over the cusp of the Reformation, he is actually a powerful mouthpiece for what Catholics believe. The use of his human bodies has been interpreted every way you can imagine, particularly in modern art history, but he does tell you why he only does the human body. And he told you in a poem that he wrote when he painted The Last Judgment, it is the line, that this beautiful line, nor hath God deigned to show himself elsewhere more clearly than in human form sublime, which, since they image him, they alone I adore. And so if this works, I would like to just sort of add this, sort of leave a little thought, a little music to think about him. Please work. Thank you so much for having me.